What's the word, y'all? I hope y'all realize how blessed we are as basketball enjoyers, man. The second night in a row of the playoffs where we had a three-game slate and all three of the games were a banger, man. That don't happen often, bro. It feels like there's always that one game you turn off in the third quarter because you feel very confident that the other team ain't coming back. Today, you didn't have that confidence. We had three bangers. And before I dive deep into these things, let me give you the Clip Notes version of them, all right? The Minnesota Timberwolves had two separate 20-point leads in the game, and they proceeded to lose both leads and lose the game where, the Target Center was rocking the first playoff game in Minnesota. Next amount of time, the fans wanted it, and the players seemed like they didn't, especially in that fourth quarter. And that brought out a lot of toxicity. We're going to dive deeper into that a little bit later. Game number two, Jalen Brunson and the Dallas Mavericks played Rudy Gobert off the floor. Basically, the first time Rudy Gobert has legitimately been played off the floor. You know what I'm saying? There's been times where he might not have looked great, but this is the first time Quinn Snyder's like, oh, damn, I actually got to do it. And Jalen Brunson's looking at all 30 teams and saying, hey, I'm worth every single penny you think I'm worth, plus an extra 10 am. Shout out to Jalen Brunson. Get your bag, King. And then lastly, the Warriors go up 3-0 in a game where Jokic tried to do everything he can. 37, 18, and 5. Some steals, some blocks. They didn't have enough because Steph Curry off the bench is still the greatest sixth man of all time. Jordan Poole, this is not a hot streak. Jordan Poole is just legit. Draymond Green, defense was great. And Klay Thompson hit like 9 threes, it felt like. Banger after banger after banger. Before we dive into these things, man, I want to remind you that I have a newsletter. I am a proud owner of a newsletter where we have some of the best writers in the game that are keeping you up to date with all things basketball. It is the Enjoy Basketball newsletter, and we're trying to hit our next milestone, and we can't do that without you. Hit that link in the description completely free, and you get updates to your email once we drop articles or once we drop things that we want you to know about the NBA. If you ain't already subscribed, I'm gonna be honest with you, you missed out on some prizes, but for sure there's more coming in the future. Before the playoffs started, all of our subscribers got an email where they were entered into this playoff bracket pool, and the winner is going to get some big things. We're having more stuff coming soon, and if you want to be a guy that's in on the merch, the Enjoy Basketball newsletter subscribers are getting notifications first, and it's very, very limited. So hit the link in the description, man. Enjoy Basketball newsletter. Let's talk about this game where the Minnesota Timberwolves just couldn't do their thing. First of all, it started off amazingly, right? Patrick Beverley started off with, I think, the first 9 points in the entire game. My hair is bugging. The first 9 points of the entire game, he's getting MVP chance, and they going crazy. Anthony Harris is hitting his shots. D'Angelo Russell's more aggressive this game than the last game, and it was one thing they really needed from him. And then the second quarter comes around, and they look terrible. We're like, oh, all the shot making that they did in the first half, all the great defense that they had in the first quarter is gone. But no big deal, right? Because in the third quarter, they built that lead right back up, and we're talking about a 20-something point lead in the fourth quarter, and they proceeded to score 9 points. I know they finished with 12 because Anthony Edwards hit a late three. They had 9 points for the first 11 and a half minutes of the fourth quarter, and the defense was atrocious. And the person that's getting the finger pointed at them the most, as you can imagine, is Karl-Anthony Towns. He played about 33 minutes on the court. He had 8 points. He had 5 personal fouls, 4 turnovers, and 5 rebounds. He matched his fouls with his rebounds as the center, but I'm giving a little pass because V8 began a lot of boards. He has played 4 postseason, postseason games this year. 2 of them, he did not crack 10 points. Unacceptable for the franchise player, unacceptable for a potential all-NBA center that is known for his offensive side of the ball. People have said that he's one of the most skilled big men of all time, and two times this year, he's proceeded to give his team nothing. And I talked about this in the last game they played in Memphis, where Karl-Anthony Towns has his way to commit fouls in the worst ways possible. It's not like I'm at the rim, heavily contested shots, and dang, I hit that man on the arm. All right, my fault. It's like sticking his leg out on jump shots, setting super bad screens, or in the foul that brought him out of the fourth quarter was bad. I want to say, for some context, we are like 3.5 minutes and into the fourth quarter, and they don't have a field goal. The Minnesota Timberwolves have not put up a field goal, and the Memphis Grizzlies are rolling. And at this point, Karl-Anthony Towns has only attempted 3 shots on the game. Think about that. He's attempted 3 shots in 30 minutes of play up to this point. I understand what's going on right now. He is our offense usually. Let's get him the ball, right? So let's see what happens on this possession. He sees Brandon Clark. He's like, you know what? Get through Malik. I got Brandon. I'm going to try to take him one-on-one. He hooks Brandon. That's an offensive foul. And Cat has never committed a foul in his entire life. Never any accountability. 99.9% of refs are calling this an offensive foul because it is. You can't lock an arm like that and push it to the side. And now, Coach Finch had to bring you out the game because we can't risk you getting that last foul. Because wait, in the play-in, we didn't pull you out the game, and you did got that sixth foul. So now your team is playing at a disadvantage again, and they blew this game and they lose this game. It was bad. And it got the own fan base booing them. And you know what? I don't blame them. If I was at this game as a Minnesota Timberwolves fan, I am very pro boo your own team if they're playing like ass. Very, very pro that. You know what I'm saying? Very, very pro. You got to let them know, listen, we love you, but you ain't do what we needed you to do today. And they didn't, right? So with a game blown like that, an embarrassing blowout or an embarrassing blown lead, I decided that I want to go to the subreddit of the Minnesota Timberwolves and just see what the fans are saying. This is not the first time we've done it. It's actually the first time we've done it in the postseason, but we did it earlier in the season when the Boston Celtics blew that huge lead to the Chicago Bulls. And we went into their subreddit with a hazmat suit on, and we just read all of the wild takes and all of the people that are tweeting or writing with emotion. And I don't blame them, right? If your team just gave up this big old lead, especially in the playoffs, this is a little bit different than the Boston Celtics one, because guess what? The Boston Celtics turned their season around. So I would love to go back and go through that video and see some of the wild things that were said and see how they hold up now that the Boston Celtics are like really, really good. But I don't blame whatever we're going to read in the Timberwolves subreddit because, well, this is a one game against the number two seed in the league or in the conference. And you won home court advantage by stealing game one at their court, and you just gave it back up on a game where you had this thing secure. You just couldn't be terrible for 12 minutes, and they were terrible for 11 and a half, and that blew it. So I'm just going to browse the subreddit, read some of the things, and see if they overreacted or not, you know? So 3 hours ago, this Redditor said, undoubtedly the most embarrassing game of the season. What a horrible showing by just about everybody tonight. Cat being a baby and giving teenage tantrum energy. Finch being unable to coach. Two 20-point leads blown, all from the home crowd who just want to see and help the team win. This is by far the worst. Yeah, okay. The top comment says, season, I've watched since... hey, this is what I'm here for. I've watched since 89-90. This is a top five loss of all time easily on a national stage. Worst loss of all time, in my opinion. And I've been here too. Cheer for guys like Michael Williams, Sam Mitchell, and Doug West. Where we were nothing. Sat through 7 straight first round exits. Watch KG go win elsewhere. Tried to get myself hype up for draft picks like Johnny Flynn. Oh, outs. Now he's diving deep into the bodies of the Minnesota Timberwolves fans by bringing up the name Johnny Finch, who got drafted over Steph Curry. Watch Jimmy Butler dumps the fire. And now this is as bad as it gets. Time to overreact. Cat does not deserve a Supermax extension. Once again, in a big game, Karl Anthony Towns was terrible offensively, taking only 4 shots from the field. Teams are showing that they can take him out of games by putting smaller guys on him. Also, he fouls at the highest rate in the league and is a very poor decision maker. This on top of his inability to recognize that a lot of the mistakes are fouls and not the ref's fault makes him very difficult to watch a lot of the time. Didn't I just say that he's never committed a foul in his life because he's going to argue everything? I am sure this will age poorly, but after watching this epic collapse, this is my take. And I'm glad he kind of had the self-awareness to know that he is overreacting and that this might not age well. I'm going to say again, I'm a big fan of Karl Anthony Towns. I mean, no ill will to him as we're going through this. We're just doing this for entertainment. Okay, cool. Can't wait for Cat to have a decent first quarter, then get called for a weak foul and get pitched about it, then truck someone drawing the foul the next possession that ends up shutting down the rest of the game. Yeah, like I said, that's what he does. He deserves the goddamn mid-level set. The mid-level with these stinky stinkers recently. The mid-level is wild. Bro, Alex Caruso side for the mid-level, which was like a dub, by the way. Shout out to the Chicago Bulls. But the mid-level, we've played 4 play-in/playoff games so far. I'm pretty sure he's crossed 20-point mark once. 11, 29, 15. I didn't even realize that game 3 is a 15 because they won. So who cares if he had 15 and 8? Generally embarrassing. Wow. How about 19 fouls in the last 4 games? God. This guy fouled more times tonight than he took shots. Just unbelievable. And this guy, he has a Karl Anthony Towns flair. He keep it in a buck. Oh, man. Not a missing poster for your franchise player. Oh, man. Not a missing poster for the franchise player. Can anyone explain why Finch didn't call timeout? A 15-0 and an 18-0 run, not a single timeout. I generally don't understand it, and except Finch gets roasted in post-game interviews. Oh, my God. We got to go to the post-game thread. That's where all the toxicity is going to go. And you know what? We're going to go by controversial. Oh, let's get it. Let's get it. Fire Finch on the spot. Not calling the timeout during a 21-0 run is the worst thing I've ever seen as a Timberwolves coach do. And I want to remind you that the Timberwolves once upon a time employed Tom Thibodeau, who's playing people 45 minutes a game. Seattle, take them, please. Bro, trying to relocate the whole organization. Oh, no. Grizzly fan here. This might be the last one we get to because I know we got two other games that we want to talk about, but this is too good to not just dive into. I recommend you doing this after every loss because it's fun. I just don't do it every video because toxicity is enough. Like, I could get just a small amount of toxicity, then I gotta be wholesome for the rest of the week. Grizzly fan here. Do y'all hate Cat? He's undoubtedly very good at basketball most of the time. He just whines about everything and looks so damn goofy when he does. We've waited 7 years for him to get that attitude, that it factor, that dog in him, but he just doesn't have it. He's cool being comfortable and chilling with his streamer buddies. Wow. Now we talk about his Twitch career. He's been a no-show in both playoff series in his career. He's the reason Jimmy Butler flew off the handle and wanted to get out of here. He saw who Cat really was. Damn, bro. Series is not over, all things considered. So we got to see how they retaliate. Carthy Towns needs a good 40-piece or something to get the fans back on his side. Let's go to the next game. We not spending nearly as many times on these games, but the Dallas Mavericks finally got Quinn Snyder to make an adjustment, and the adjustment was let Rudy Gobert sit on the bench. And you know what? When he was on the bench, no, they couldn't get stops, which is that's still a consensus. Whether Rudy was on the floor or not, they couldn't get stops. But the offense was better with their small ball five. And if there's any silver lining, that's it. You still lost a game to a team that didn't have Luka Doncic. Donovan Mitchell went to his post-game interview, y'all, and he was like, it all starts on defense. They were roasting his ass the entire game. They were actively trying to get Donovan Mitchell on the ball handler the entire game. Bro went to the post-game interview and said, hey, it starts on defense. Like, he was the guy out there clamping. Like he was the dude that was giving us all on the defensive side of the ball. Because honestly, it wasn't him. It wasn't anybody today. They gave 126 points to a team that didn't have Luka. The small ball five, shout out to Eric Pascoe, the homie. Eric came in and gave them a good little jolt when they went on his run. But other than that, man, this man Jalen Brunson hit so many tough shots, bro, in the lane. And Maxi Kleber came off the bench, and he's just still shooting lights out. And then Maxi Kleber went to the bench, and they brought in Davis Bertans, who the world forgot that once upon a time was one of the most lethal shooters in the entire league. He came in like, oh, yeah, you thought you was getting a breather with Maxi on the bench. Absolutely not. Dorian Finney-Smith hit a big old shot down the stretch. And though Spencer Dinwiddie didn't have a great shooting night, he had the one shot, shot clock winding down, 2 seconds left, step back, like 30-footer, bang. And that was a big momentum shifter because that was when Utah was trying to have a little fight back. Yeah, I think we can all agree that it's time for the Jazz team to just call it wraps with this current construction of the team. So that's all I got to say about it. Luka's probably coming back soon. But they don't even necessarily need him to at this rate. Get healthy for the next round, dog. Get healthy for the next round because it don't seem like your boys need you at the moment. They'll probably need you in round two, whether it is with the Pels, who, you know what I'm saying? They took a game, and they got a chance to go up 2-1 tomorrow, or the Suns if they could continue to do their thing. The last game. I don't have a ton to say about this game. It is a 3-0 lead for the Warriors. In my little breakdown, my Spark Notes version, that's pretty much it, bro. Klay Thompson ended up hitting his 6 threes. He had 26. Jordan Poole had 27. Steph Curry had 27. And Gary Payton hit 3 threes. Like, what are you supposed to do? Jokic and the guys, they tried, bro. They legitimately tried, and Aaron Gordon had his best game of the playoffs so far because he had been terrible up until this point. Jokic ended up with 37, 18, 5, and 3 steals. He tried his best, but they just don't have enough firepower to match what the Warriors got. Draymond Green played amazing defense down the stretch in the close game, getting that pickpocket on Nikola Jokic and a couple more stops. They got to make their free throws, though. They shot 64% from the free throw. A team with Steph Curry and Jordan Poole on it shot 64%. Steph Curry missed 2, and Jordan Poole missed 3. That's crazy to me. That's crazy to me. Those boys don't. And Iggy got up for a posterizer. That's all, bro. That's all I got to say. You know what I'm saying? Down 0-3. The season, the series is over for the Nuggets. So hopefully we get one more masterclass of great performance at the bare minimum for Jokic before we call it wraps and expect them to be contenders next year when Jamal and Michael come back. I kind of want to go back to the subreddit low-key. I will go back in the subreddit, but I think that's wraps for me on this video. Tomorrow, the Bulls have their first playoff game in Chicago in, what, 5 years, 6 years, and I won't be there. It hurts my heart. It truly, truly does. Because I told myself, since I've had this relative success on YouTube, the next time the Bulls make the playoffs, I'm going to be there. I'm going to be at the game. But when baby Ave's being born, I can't bring myself to go to it. You know, you're probably saying, can he get a babysitter? Bro, she's less than a week old. I would feel weird leaving her alone with somebody, even if it is like her grandma, my mom. I would feel weird with leaving her alone for 4 or 5 hours when she ain't even a week old into this world. You know what I'm saying? Gotta protect my baby, so I'll be rooting for the boys, man. Best believe it, I'll be rooting for the boys. And once we hit the NBA finals, she'll be a couple months old, and then we just put the headphones on her and take her to the game. So the Bulls just gotta still laugh so we can get to the finals so Avery can go to a basketball game.